Today we are going to begin a somewhat different subject, okay, which is also related to renormalization. And this is for renormalization too. So I'll try to illustrate this in the context of gauge theory coupled to formulas, but the general idea is valid for all quantum field theories. So let me discuss it first in the context of gauge theory coupled to formulas, and then we'll discuss the general things. So let's say we have a gauge theory coupled to formulas. And let's suppose that we want with fixed epsilon, fixed E, which is 4 minus epsilon, till the end, okay, and I'll explain what I mean by till the end, and then take epsilon goes to 0 limit. And ultimately, of course, we are interested in the epsilon goes to 0 limit, but we'll take this limit only at the very end. So if we work at fixed epsilon, then everything is finite, okay? Because even in the before renormalization, everything is finite because everything depends on epsilon. So the original theory then has some parameters, which are called G alpha M. These are parameters. G for renormalization. Parameters, let's say parameters in original, of the original language. This means that all physical quantities I can express as a function of G alpha and M. Okay, because these are functions of original parameters, and as long as I keep epsilon fixed, these are finite functions of G alpha and M. On the other hand, if we renormalize, okay, keeping epsilon finite, so we can still renormalize keeping epsilon finite. Then in the renormalized theory, all quantities are functions of GR alpha mu mod and mu, where mu is the renormalized mass parameter that we are introduced. Basically, these are the three renormalized parameters, and this is the mu which we introduced because when we wrote the expression for G, we took it GR mu to the epsilon by 2. Right, that's for dimensional reasons. So now see that here you have three parameters, here you have four. At fixed epsilon, G alpha and M are functions of GR alpha, MR and mu. Okay, by those general relations, that G is ZG GR mu to the epsilon by 2, alpha is Z alpha alpha R, and M is ZM MR. Okay, and these ZG, Z alpha, ZM are of course functions of GR and possibly mu at fixed epsilon. So So because you have three variables here and four variables here, in general we can change gr, alpha, mr and mu in such a way that these remain fixed. Okay, there are four parameters here, three parameters here, so we should be able to vary these. There should be one parameter family of choices for gr, alpha, mr and mu which gives the same g alpha and m. Is that clear? In other words, let's suppose that you want to keep g alpha and m fixed. We are given some specific g alpha and m. Now, this gives you three equations in four variables, right? Because you want to keep g alpha and m fixed, so the left hand side is fixed. So this gives you three equations involving gr, mu, alpha and mr. So it must be possible to change gr, mu, alpha and mr. So because there are four variables and three equations, the solution is not unique, but the solution should be parametrically one parameter. Okay? And for all of those solutions, all physical quantities should remain the same, because physical quantities depend on g alpha and m. Okay? Physical quantities can be expressed in principle as functions of g alpha and m. The only problem was that if we express them as functions of g alpha and m, we cannot really take the epsilon goes to zero limit, keeping everything finite. But if you are working at a fixed epsilon, then it should be possible to express the physical quantities in terms of these. And this means that if we change gr, mu, alpha and mr in such a way that these remain fixed, then all physical quantities should remain fixed. Is that clear? So let me write it here. So if we change gr, alpha, mr, mu such that gm, alpha are unchanged, then physical quantities are unchanged. Yeah, so we'll express the observables as a function of gr, alpha, mr and mu. Okay? You'll get some function of gr, alpha, mr and mu, but it should depend only through these combinations. Okay? Then you can express, of course, because since each of these are functions of gr, mu, alpha and mr, okay, you should be able to express all observables in terms of these variables. Okay? And that is useful in taking the epsilon goes to zero limit. Okay? Because if you had expressed the observables in terms of these variables, you couldn't take the epsilon goes to zero limit, getting a finite design. But if you are working at a fixed epsilon, not before taking the limit, right? Then if we change these so that these remain the same, then the result shouldn't change. Is that clear? So this basically says that there must be some functional relationship between gr, alpha and mr and mu, such that if that relationship is satisfied, okay, then you can vary these quantities, okay, without changing the physical results. Okay. So let me write it here, then it will become clear. So let's single out mu as the parameter that you have to vary. Okay. So we can change mu, that if we change mu, it should be possible to change gr alpha in r such that g in alpha remains fixed. Yeah, these Zs?
Yes, so you
can fix by varying. Yeah, see, these are functions of GR, alpha, MR, and mu, right? So these we can calculate and express as a function of GR, alpha, and MR. So they're not independent variables. Is this point clear? Right. So what he said is that out of these four, right, we should have a one parameter family for which the result doesn't change, because here are three equations, four variables, right? So mu can be chosen to be arbitrary, right? And as you vary mu, you have to correspondingly change gr, alpha, and mr, so as to leave the results unchanged. Okay, we can change mu arbitrarily, but then how you vary this should be fixed, okay? Because they have to be varied precisely to satisfy these equations. Okay. Why this is useful, it will become clear later. Okay. But let's see how we can find these relations. Okay, how we should change R, for example. So the general principle is exactly what I said, that we have to assume that there is some functional dependence. We can write a GR of mu, alpha of mu, and MR of mu. We are trying to determine what these functional relationships are, okay, such that as you change mu and as you vary and at the same time vary these according to these functions, these remain unchanged. Okay. And the way this is implemented is by saying that mu dv mu of g should be 0, mu dv mu of alpha should be 0, and mu dv mu of n should be 0. Where dd mu means a total change. See, when you take the relationship between g and the other variables, right, there are of course explicit dependencies through this mu over here. Okay. But then gr, we are making it dependent on mu, right? In fact, we are supposed to make gr dependent on mu precisely in a way so the mu dependence cancels in this relation. Okay, you have to make gr dependent on mu. There is a GR dependent GR inside ZG also, right? So you have to make GR dependent on mu so that this whole thing becomes independent of mu, because you don't want G to change. Right? Similarly, we want alpha to dependent on mu, okay, so that this whole thing doesn't change as you change mu. Right? And the same here. So these are the equations. Oh, this is just a matter of convention. It doesn't matter. This operation is useful. Mu dd mu would be a useful operation. Right. But otherwise, of course, this is the same as saying dd mu of alpha equal to 0, dd mu of g equal to 0, and so on. So let's just do this calculation brute force, okay, using one loop denormalization. Okay, at one loop, we know what the denormalization constants look like. Okay. So, zg at one loop has the structure 1 plus AG over epsilon times GR square. This is just constant. Yeah, this is in the minimal subtraction scheme. If you use another scheme, there could be some finite collections. Okay, in the minimal subtraction scheme, this is what the ZG is. Z alpha is 1 plus B alpha over epsilon times GR square. And Zm is 1 plus m over epsilon times gr square. Right? These are the quantities that we have calculated. Well, I didn't calculate, you are supposed to calculate this, right? I gave the results. Okay, this is part of the homework problem to calculate these coefficients a, g, alpha, and m. Now, we will not use too much information from about these constants, except one information which will be useful at the intermediate stage. If you remember, if you look at the expression for AG, you will find that AG actually is just a constant, determined in terms of the CGs and CRs and so on. A alpha, on the other hand, depends on alpha. Right? If you look at the expression for A alpha, you will find that there is an alpha dependence in the expression for A alpha. Okay, if you go back to the notes, A alpha Z alpha, right, was the same as Z tilde I. Okay, Z alpha was the same as Z tilde I, and in the expression for Z tilde I, you will find that there is an alpha dependence. Sitting again, this AM is independent of alpha. Alpha. Okay, so let's now implement this. So first we'll try to impose mu dd mu of g equal to 0. So mu dd mu of Zg was 1 plus Ag over epsilon Gr square times Gr mu to the epsilon by 2 equal to 0. Yes.
GR
was dimensionless, yes. Yeah, so the way you have to think of this is that it's relating GR as if it will be like GR of mu over mu naught. Okay, mu naught will be some reference scale. Okay? And if you change mu to some by some arbitrary constant, GR will change. Okay? That's the way you should think of as GR of mu.
Some sort of scaling.
Yeah, exactly. Okay? So you have to fix a reference. GR of mu naught. See, the point is that GR is not a universal function of mu, right? What this means is the following, that if you take, say, if you take mu equal to mu naught, and GR equal to GR naught, okay? Suppose the initially it was mu equal to mu naught, GR equal to GR naught, and so on. Then, if you change from mu naught to some other value, mu equal to mu naught prime, there should be a rule that tells you how you should change GR. So exactly. To GR prime such that your G is fixed. Right? This is what it means. Okay, so when you actually express GR as a function of mu, you will find that there is a mu naught dependence also. Right? It's not a universal function in the sense that you should be able to keep mu fixed and change GR also, right? Because for a fixed mu you can choose different couplings. Which will give different physical GRs. Right? If you fix mu and change GR, then that will effectively change G alpha and M. Okay, so that's also an allowed change. Okay? Is there that change doesn't leave the theory unchanged. Okay? When I say GR of mu, okay, it just means how should you change GR such that it remains unchanged. Is this clear? Okay, so if this equation is clear, right? This is G, so G should be unchanged, okay, and I have just expressed G in terms of GR. So this quantity is GR plus AR over epsilon times GR cube. Okay. So this has two pieces. One is that because GR has to be allowed to depend on mu, okay, there will be tan proportional to dGR dmu. Right? Because GR is allowed to depend on mu. Okay, we are trying to determine how GR should depend on mu so that this doesn't change. Okay. So we get mu dGR dmu times 1 plus 3 vr over epsilon vr square mu to the epsilon by 2 plus vr plus ag over epsilon gr cube and then mu dd mu of mu to the epsilon by 2 okay, which you can check is epsilon by 2 and mu to the epsilon by 2 that dd mu of mu to the epsilon by 2 is epsilon by 2 term times mu to the epsilon by 2 minus 1 and then you multiply back by mu so it becomes this. So this now allows you to calculate mu pgr dmu, which is gr times epsilon by 2 times 1 plus ag over epsilon gr square over 1 plus 3 over epsilon gr square. Okay. And now you have to remember that you are doing part of an expansion, right? There are of course corrections of order gr to the 4th in this deformation constant, right? Which you have not taken into account. So you can write this as gr times epsilon by 2 times 1 minus 2 ag over epsilon gr square. That's order gr. And here you notice that even though these are divergent formally, right? Ultimately, when you take epsilon goes to zero limit, of course, this diverges. Okay? But the epsilon goes to zero limit is always taken after you have done expansion in GR. Okay, this is always the rule in perturbation theory, okay? That you will keep the regulator fixed. Okay? First, carry out the expansion in the coupling constant, okay? And then collecting all terms to a given order in expansion, you take epsilon goes to zero. That has to be done at the very end. Okay, so that's what allows us to expand this in powers of GR. Now this expanded in Taylor series and multiplied, and that's what you get here. Is this point clear? Let me write here. Yes, mu dgr dmu. I'll now expand this out. So epsilon by 2 times gr minus.
There should have been a minus sign.
There should have been a minus sign.
Yeah, on the right.
Oh yeah, that should be. Yeah, there is a.
Or minus sign on the right.
Yeah. Minus epsilon by 2 times gr plus ag times gr square gr cube plus you can see that the correction should be order gr to the 5, right? But the expansion is in parts of gr square, so there is always a gr sitting outside. Okay, and when you expand this out, the order gr to the 4 terms you have not taken into account. Okay, so there will be overall correction of order gr to the exist here. And now you can take epsilon goes to 0 limit if you want. Okay, but we'll need this for other calculations. Okay, but in the limit epsilon goes to 0, we get AG times GR cube. And this is what is called a beta function for the coupling GR. So, by definition, this is beta G of GR. Okay. So, this is beta function. So, what is this equation telling us? This equation is telling us that if we find a solution to this equation, right? Of course, the solution is not unique. Then you have to put an initial condition. Right? So you put some mu equal to mu naught, where you can put gr to anything that you like. That's your coupling constant. Okay, that's the input data that controls the theory. Take some mu equal to mu naught. You choose some gr naught, and this is telling us then that if you change mu to some other value, then and if you change gr according to this equation, then the theory remains the same. The physical quantities will remain the same. We have to do also similar things with alpha r and mr, which I'll describe later. But as far as gr is concerned, this is how we have to change gr so that the theory remains the same.
Why didn't you take the order gr
because we haven't calculated, right? Because ag we only calculated of the zg, we calculated only up to order gr squared, right? So to be consistent, okay, we can only keep up to order gr square, right? If we had calculated the full zg up to next order, right, then while expanding also you have to keep up to the next order. Because you always have to make sure that you can only keep terms up to the order in which you have calculated everything.
In that case, there would have been some 1 over epsilon square and those.
Exactly.
But then multiply
the external epsilon. That is true. But the point is, you don't know for sure if this 1 over epsilon square wouldn't be cancelled against some other epsilon, 1 over epsilon square coming from 2 loop calculation. Exactly, right? So, in fact, what will happen is that when you do a 2 loop calculation, right, there will be 1 over epsilon square which will cancel this. Right? So, this is something that I'm not going to prove, but it's true that at the end, after you have taken into account all corrections, if you take the epsilon goes to 0 limit, you actually get a finite result. Okay, so this 1 over epsilon square, right, which you have to multiply to epsilon to give you a possible divergence, okay, that 1 over epsilon square actually gets cancelled against an explicit contribution from 2 loops. Is this clear? Exactly. That it will always cancel.
That's
the theory. That determines what the theory is. Yes. Yes.
And then, so this choice of mu naught and g naught are essentially like independent, right?
Yeah. Initially, you choose some mu naught, right? And you from experiments, right? Mu naught you can fix to be whatever you like.
Yes.
Okay. But because as we saw that there is one parameter family, right? On which nothing depends. So you fix mu naught, you can choose to be anything you like. Yeah. And for that choice of mu naught, you compare it with an experiment.
Yeah.
To fix your gr naught, alpha naught, and mr naught. Okay, by looking at experimental data. Now, the point is that for the same experimental data, you can also explain if you change mu to some other value, provided you also change your gr and alpha and mr according to this equation. Is that clear? That this equation, of course, the solution is not unique. You have to say what the initial condition. And the initial condition will be that at mu equal to mu naught, gr equal to gr naught. Okay? That you know that for mu equal to mu naught, that gr naught, alpha naught, and mr naught explains your experiment. Okay? But now the statement is that if we change mu to something else, and at the same time change gr, alpha, and mr to something else according to these equations, you will continue to satisfy the same experimental results. Okay? That the physical observables do not change. If you change gr, alpha, and mr, in accordance to these equations. Is this point clear? So this is the way you have to think of gr being a function of mu, right? It's not that once mu is given, gr is fixed, right? We have a choice of what gr is. For any given mu, okay, what you choose for gr alpha and mr is determined by experiment, by comparing the experiments. Okay, the theory allows you to have any gr alpha and mu for a given mu. So in that sense, you shouldn't think of gr as a given function of mu. Okay. But given that that one particular physical situation where we have fixed your gr alpha and mu mr for a given mu, then you have a possibility of changing your mu and at the same time changing gr alpha and mr following these equations, such that the same experiment can be explained. Because this experiment has not changed under these changes.
So,
so
it means now say that this experiment, whatever methodology of explaining that, is the whole parameter space of this experiment.
Exactly. That you can explain that experiment by choosing mu equal to 1. We say mu equal to 1 GeV and of some particular values of GR alpha and M1, or mu equal to 2 GeV and some other values of GR alpha and M1, and so on. Okay, but how you go from 1 GeV to 2 GeV, you have to get by solving these equations.
I have to
ask you,
in the denominator F7 tends to 0, so that quantity is always greater than 1.
Yeah, yeah, but the point, that's what I said, that you have to first make the GR expansion before taking epsilon goes to 0 limit. Right? That to any given order, right, you have to first do a GR expansion, okay, then make sure that you keep only up to those terms for which you are sure that you have calculated all the terms, right? That you can ask, what about gr to the fourth term, right? When you expand it out, that will come with 1 over epsilon square. But the point is that to the calculation that we have done so far, the calculation of zg, okay, we have not taken into account order gr to the fourth term, right? That requires a two-loop calculation, right? Which could have gr to the fourth term, the epsilon square term, coming from two loops. Exactly. At the time of expansion, you will not consider epsilon goes to 0 limit. You will first work up to a given order in expansion, okay, and then take the epsilon goes to 0 limit at the very end. Right? This is always the philosophy of renormalization, that whatever the renormalization means, that you first expand out in parts of the coupling constant, connect all terms to a given order in coupling constant, okay, and then at the very end, you take the epsilon goes to 0 limit. This is clear. So you always think of these terms as small, even though there is an 1 over epsilon sitting in the sitting there. So, okay, are there any other questions? Now, there is a, if look at this coefficient AG, AG is just a constant, right? It turns out there is a qualitative difference between positive AG and negative AG, right? And let's see what the qualitative difference is. Then suppose AG is positive. Okay? And you start with some mu, okay, say mu equal to mu naught, and assume that GR is small to begin with. GR naught is small. Okay, you take some mu equal to mu naught and small gr naught. Now, if you increase mu, okay, then you see that the right hand side is positive, because if AG is positive, right? Some small positive gr naught. Let me write small positive gr naught. Okay, actually, it doesn't matter if it's positive or negative. So here the right hand side is positive, okay, and so as you increase mu, GR starts increasing. Is that clear? Because the equation is mu dgr mu d mu equal to this. So if GR, if AG is positive, then as you increase mu, GR starts increasing. Okay. So even if you start with a small GR, okay, at large mu, GR becomes large. Okay, so GR becomes large at large mu. Large mu And then you have to worry about whether the other higher order collections can play a role. Now, if GR starts with a negative, okay, it's actually the similar story. Suppose GR starts with negative, then the right hand side is negative, okay, which means that as you increase mu, GR becomes more and more negative, okay, because you start with a negative GR, okay, right hand side is negative. Which means the GR decreases, right? That means it becomes more and more negative. Okay, so it goes away from zero. That's the point. If AG is negative, then GR goes away from zero, even if you start at GR equal to zero. If AG is negative, it's exactly opposite. So if you start with a small positive GR, then GR becomes smaller. At large value. These theories are called asymptotically free theories. Right now it looks like just a technical result because mu is of course some parameter, right? Who cares if what happens to GR when mu increases or decreases, right? But later on we will see why this is useful in making some predictions for Gauge theories or in general quantum field theories which have this property. Okay? But right now the thing to remember is that if GR starts decreasing towards zero as you increase mu, then you call the theory asymptotically free. The other way, if GR in this case, right, you can say that as mu decreases, GR becomes smaller. Okay? So these are called infrared free. Okay? This becomes free in the infrared. Okay, small mu. So small mu is infrared, large mu is ultraviolet. Okay? But as I said, right now it's just a technical word because we have mu is not a physical quantity, right? Mu is not something that we measure in experiments. Okay, so why the change with respect to mu has any physical significance will not become clear till later. Okay, right now you think of this as just names, that if the coupling decreases as at large mu, then it's asymptotically free. If the coupling decreases at small mu, then it's infrared free.
So if you choose any one parameter, because
So the point is that normally this statement of asymptotic freedom refers to the expansion parameter, right? In this case, it is true there are other parameters, MR and alpha, yeah, right? But the perturbation expansion is in GR, yeah, right? So having small GR helps because that means that the higher order collections are smaller. For MR and alpha, you don't worry too much about what is happening to those. But for the GR becomes small or large, makes a difference because that's what determines whether the perturbation expansion is becoming better or small, worse, right? So if there are more than one coupling constant, which more than one perturbation parameters, right, then a theory will be called asymptotically free if all coupling constants become small at high mu. Okay, it may happen that typically if you have a theory with multiple coupling constants, so suppose you have a standard model, right? In the standard model, there are these three coupling constants, right? The SU3 gauge group coupling constant, SU2 and U1, right? And then there are the Higgs coupling, the lambda phi dagger phi whole square term. That's also an interaction term, right? So you can ask how those various couplings run, as how do they vary as a function of mu. Okay? And in general, not all of them decrease, right? Some of them decrease, some of them increase as we increase mu. Okay? But so that's not strictly either asymptotically free or infrared free, right? Because in the one direction some couplings increase, in the other direction some other couplings increase. Okay, so that can certainly happen. Yeah, are there other questions?
Sir, mu naught as an input current to open the start, that suppose we are measuring some experimental
No. So mu naught is completely up to you. Okay. Suppose you have an experimental measurement, right? You given an experimental measurement, you cannot determine from that mu, gr, alpha, and mr separately. Because there's one parameter family which will give you exactly the same experimental result. Right? So mu you can fix yourself. Right? You decide what mu you want to use. Say mu equal to 1 g. Okay, that's how you call mu naught. With respect to that, you can calculate gr naught, mr naught, and alpha naught, okay, by comparing the experiment. Okay. Now the point is that if you suppose then you decide that you want to change your mu naught, right? You are not satisfied with 1 g, you will make it 10 g. Okay. One is that you again calculate everything from scratch, right, and compare the experiment. Then you calculate the S matrix with this different value of mu, compare the experiments, and determine again GR, MR, and alpha. Right? But the other possibility where you can approach is that you just solve these equations. You already have determined what GR, MR, and alpha are if you have chosen mu equal to 1 GeV. Right? Now you just use these equations to determine what GR, MR, and alpha should be if mu is 10 GeV. Right? These are entirely equivalent. You can either directly compare the experiments and determine the value of GR, MR, and alpha at B equal to 10 GeV, or you just solve these equations to determine what they are. Is this point clear?
So, what do we measure in experiment is mu, G, alpha, and A?
Well, the point is yes, that would be the case if this problem of alpha and divergence had not been there. Right? Because experiments are done at epsilon equal to 0, right? So you cannot strictly say that this is what to measure in an experiment, right? But, so it's a gradient between two things. One is that if we express the experiment results in terms of G, alpha, and M, there is no extraneous parameter, okay? But that those relations are divergent in the epsilon goes to zero limit. Okay? On the other hand, if you express the experimental results in terms of G, R, alpha, and MR, and mu, then that has final nice alpha, epsilon goes to zero limit, right? But the problem now is that you have too many parameters, right? You have four parameters instead of three. So there must be some relationship between these four parameters, okay, such that if you change the parameters according to those relations, the experimental results don't change. Right? And this is what is giving those relations.
So as of now, mu is not a physical scale.
No, as of now, mu is not a physical scale. It's some arbitrary parameter that you can choose yourself. Right? For that given choice of mu, you determine the coupling constants by comparing the experiment. Okay. You can change that parameter and then you will get a different set of coupling constants for the same experiment. Is this point clear? Okay, now.
But how do you know that we need different say we have chosen 1 GeV, but
yes.
How do you know we don't need that? We need
It's not a question of knowing. It's completely up to you. It's just convenience.
Okay.
Right? You may find working with mu equal to 1 GeV convenient or mu equal to 10 GeV convenient. Right? That we'll see why. Right? Why is sometimes one more convenient than the other? We'll see it later. Okay? But the choice of mu is completely up to you.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just something that you can choose. And for given mu, you determine the other parameters by comparing the experiment.
So, for instance, the spine structure constant,
yes, that it has a value at, say, energy scale M0 and some at some other value.
The usual
values
we find in the
PBTL. Yes.
So, they are corresponding to some experimentally observed.
That's right. So, I have not told you so far, right, how mu is related to experimental observation, right? Right now, mu is just a parameter that you can choose to be anything that you like, right? That has nothing to do with what experiment you are doing, right? You can do an experiment at 100 GeV and you can work with mu equal to 1 GeV, right? Because the choice of mu is completely up to you, right? Later on, we'll see what one means by saying that a fine structure constant 100 GeV, right? What exactly that means.
So, ideally, that should refer to some experimental observation.
Exactly. So, right now, what we are saying, mu has nothing to do with an experimental observation. Mu is unrelated at this stage to the energy scale that you are doing your experiment. Right? Mu is just a theoretical construct which is a Lyapunov parameter that you have introduced because your theory had this problem of divergence, having ultraviolet divergence. Is this point clear? Okay, so mu at this stage is not something such as to do the experiment, it's something that you can fix at your own will. Okay, so let's, okay, before I go on, let me just point out one more thing. That if you look at your expression for AG, for the gauge theories, I wrote down the expression for AG for gauge theory, right? Let me look at that once more. Yeah, which comes from ZG. So AG for gauge theories, AG was minus one over 8 pi square times 11 CG minus 4 PR over 6. Okay, CG was some combination of the FABC and PR was trace TATB, right? If you take trace TATB, then what the constant of proportionality is what you have called TR. So first to note is that if we have a pure gauge theory, no formula, then of course TR is 0. Okay? No fermions or fermions which are gauge neutral. Okay? It doesn't couple to gauge. Then TR is 0. Then AG is negative. So pure gauge theory is asymptotically free because we have a negative sign over here. And in fact, typically what you find that when you add fermions, you get TR. But for small number of fermions, this is still larger than this. So you still have asymptotic freedom. If you add more and more fermions, then effectively TR increases, right? Suppose instead of having one fermion in say some representation R, you add two fermions in the same representation. Then effectively TR doubles, right? Because TR is what? Trace TATB, right? The trace runs over all states in the theory. So if you double the number of fermions, TR will double. If you double the number of fermions in the same representation, TR will double. So typically, as you add more and more fermions, this coefficient starts decreasing. And once you add beyond a certain number of fermions, then you find that the coefficient has started. Okay, and instead of being negative, it now becomes positive. So the general result is that for any given gauge group, you can add a certain set of fermions and scalars without destroying asymptotic freedom. But if you add too many fermions or too many scalars or fermions or scalars in very high representation, then you destroy asymptotic freedom. Okay? So if you want asymptotic freedom, if you want your theory to have asymptotic freedom, then this is a constraint you should put, that you shouldn't put too many fermions or scalars. Okay? And how many you can put depends on the gauge group that you have chosen. So let's do this calculation for alpha. That's true. But the point is, if it's asymptotically free, then as you go to higher and higher mu, right? If it starts decreasing, so one loop result becomes better and better. So once you have an asymptotically free theory, then as long as the coupling constant at some mu is sufficiently small, you are guaranteed that as you increase mu, it becomes smaller and smaller. Okay, because the one loop result becomes better and better. Okay, so let's try to calculate the similar equation for alpha. So alpha is z alpha times alpha r, okay, which you can write as 1 plus a alpha g r square by epsilon times alpha r. And you have to keep in mind that A alpha depends on alpha. So again, we demand mu dd mu of alpha equal to 0. So where are the mu dependencies? You see that unlike in the case of gr, there is an explicit mu dependency here. Right? There is a mu to the epsilon because alpha has actually dimension 0 even in arbitrary dimensions. So now the dependence on mu will come through the implicit dependence of gr on mu because gr depends on mu and the implicit dependence on alpha on mu because alpha also depends on mu. So you get a sum of two terms. One is mu dd mu of alpha and the corresponding coefficient is 1 plus A alpha gr square by epsilon plus alpha del AR. Plus E alpha alpha or epsilon times 2 E R This is the full equation that tells you how you have to change alpha so that alpha remains unchanged under changing. So now all you have to do is to simplify things a bit. Mu dd mu of gr, I'll substitute this. And then I have to divide by this. This I can write as minus 2 A alpha alpha by epsilon gr square. I take gr square out. I just expanded this out in a power series, okay, and kept only up to the GR square term. Okay, in fact, you only have to keep the leading term, so all of this is not, also not necessary. Okay. So the leading term here is, as you can see, A alpha alpha GR square plus.
Alright, yeah.
Okay, these in fact you cannot trust, because if you work through carefully, you will see that the order gr to the 4 terms, that corrections that come here, those could combine with this minus epsilon over 2 to produce terms of the same order. Okay, so you really can trust up to this gr square term. So this is what we get to this order. And you can do a similar analysis for MR. Okay, exercise is to calculate mu DMR. Okay, but the general idea is, should be clear, that you calculate the deformation constants to a given order, and then that gives you the relationship between the unnormalized parameters and the normalized parameters. And then you try to determine how you can vary the normalized parameters as a function of mu, such that the unnormalized parameters remain unchanged. Okay, that gives a set of equations, and that's what you are after.
What is this AR?
Sorry, A alpha.
AG.
Oh, AG, yes, thank you. AG. This is AG. So this is A alpha, but this is AG. Okay, so now let's try to work out some implication of this on Green's functions. So for, if you take the unnormalized Green's functions, you see, the original phi's, right, if you take the regularized theory, fixed epsilon, okay, you have not taken epsilon goes to zero limit yet. You take the correlation functions of the original fields which appeared in the action, unnormalized action. They have no knowledge about mu. Right? We hadn't been introduced, but everything has functions of g alpha and mu. Sorry, g alpha and m. So now, if you take one such unnormalized correlation function, and then vary mu, and at the same time vary gr alpha and mr according to these equations, those unnormalized Green's functions wouldn't change. Right? That's the whole reason, right? That's what determined these equations. So this gives you the following equation, namely mu del del mu plus beta g. Oh, I'll call this beta alpha. Okay, and similarly beta m. Okay, this will be beta m. Okay, whatever function of gr you get is what I am calling beta alpha. So mu del del mu plus beta g del del gr plus beta alpha del del alpha r plus beta m del del mr, acting on product of I arbitrary n point function, Is the meaning of the situation clear? This correlation function is a function only of G, M and alpha. These reflect changes, okay, if you multiply by some say delta epsilon, then these reflect small changes in mu, gr, alpha and mr, such that g, m and alpha are unchanged. Okay? That's the way you determine these beta functions. So this shouldn't change. Is this clear? Now the point is that we don't want an equation for this because this doesn't have finite epsilon goes to zero limit. Right? So this is a tension between these two approaches, right? In one case, if we think in terms of G, M and mu, right, it's manifest that it depends only on three parameters, not four. But that doesn't have an epsilon goes to zero limit. Okay? The same is true, so even if we take GR, MR and mu R and use the unnormalized Green's functions, it still doesn't have epsilon goes to zero limit, right? To get a finite epsilon goes to zero limit, you have to also renormalize the fields. So this we know is given by product over I equal to 1 to n z tilde I to the half. These are the wave function normalizing factors. And product I equal to 1 to n IIR. So now when we apply this on this combination, there are two kinds of terms that we will get. One where this acts directly on this. This is after all product of many terms, right? So when you apply a differential operator on a product of many terms, this is a linear differential operator. You get one term where it acts on this, and then you have n different terms where it acts in turn on each of these z acts. Right? So I can write this as product over I equal to 1 to n z tilde I to the half times, let's call this differential operator D. Okay, this whole thing as some differential operator D. So D on product I equal to 1 to n I r of xi. Pardon?
Phi
I r, thank you. Phi I r of xi. Plus z tilde I to the power minus half D. Sum j equal to 1 to n, z tilde j to the minus half d, z tilde j to the half, I have already taken this out, product over z tilde I to the power half. When the differential operator acts on z tilde j to the power half, then of course this factor is not there in the product, right? So that's why I multiplied by z tilde j to the power minus half. Is this clear? This is the product of n terms, right? A1, A2 up to n. A differential operator is acting on that product, right? It acts one at a time, right? Suppose it acts on AI. Okay? Then what you will have is that you will get product of everything I equal to 1 to n, except that I not will be equal to the j, right? If it acts on dj, times this, and then the d of differential operator will act on aj. Okay? What I have done here is that I have just multiplied by aj inverse and aj. Okay, so that this product runs over all the terms, okay, but I have compensated for it by putting this minus. Is this clear? So this quantity will denote by gamma j, and it has a name which is called anomalous dimension. So I'll just explain how to calculate this gamma j. These phi i's are any fields. Okay, for gauge theory, this could be either gauge fields or fermions or even ghosts. Okay, because at this stage you are not worried about whether the operators are gauge invariant or not. You are trying to look for general Green's function. So z tilde I, right, typically has a structure of 1 plus ai alpha r by epsilon times gr square. This is a wave function Ramachandran constants, right? You calculated wave function Ramachandran constants for various cases. This typically has this structure. Again, like alpha, it doesn't have an explicit mu dependence. And wave function normalizations don't have any explicit mu dependence. So the mu dependence, I mean all this, the difference, so it doesn't have explicit mu dependence, but of course it has dependence on GR and alpha. And that's what you have to use. So then gamma I is this operator, right? This D operator acting on this. Z tilde I to the minus of D on this. So this is 1 plus ai of alpha r by epsilon gr square. Actually, I can write this. It's easy to see that this is how this is can be written as half z tilde I inverse d of z tilde I. Z tilde j inverse d of z tilde. Is that clear? If we just differentiate, right? It's half d of z tilde, right? So that and this will come z tilde to minus half. So I can write it as inverse d of 1 plus ai alpha r over epsilon gr square. So gd. Pardon?
Half.
Half, thank you. Half. Mu del del mu gives you 0 because no explicit mu dependence. Then beta g del del gr, right? So let's write it. Beta g del del gr gives you ai of alpha r over epsilon times 2 gr. Then beta alpha del del alpha r. So beta alpha del del alpha r. So gr square
all for epsilon, del ei of alpha r, del alpha r.
Okay, and you have to basically pick the leading contribution, right? Because you have to work up to lowest order. Now, beta g, it has a minus epsilon over 2 gr plus ag gr cube, right? This was the structure of beta g. And beta alpha was r, some a alpha gr square. A alpha alpha r gr square, right? This is A alpha alpha r gr square. So you see that most of these contributions are already of our gr to the 4, right? Which you don't care. The leading contribution comes from this minus epsilon by 2 gr times this. Okay? So this gives you minus half I alpha r square. Sorry, no half. This half cancels, but there is an overall factor of half which arranged into, right? This half will end into. So half of this, so half of this whole thing. Okay, so basically this half remains, right? This half and these two cancels, and then there's a minus half that comes from minus epsilon by 2 times epsilon. Whatever epsilon. Yes.
Initially
it was put out of in
j.
Yes.
In the vector. That's
right, yes.
So, but how it becomes just
2?
How it becomes
sum?
Sum is around
the j. Oh, because this will still have a product. This is factored out completely outside.
Oh, okay.
Right? Okay. And now the point is one at a time we are defined.
Okay. So,
yeah, so this factor is already common to all of them. So is this calculation here? Yeah, I mean, it's just straightforward calculation. You use the known expressions for beta g and beta alpha, and that you already calculated, and pick the leading contribution, which basically uses the this minus epsilon by 2 gr term from here, and the 1 over epsilon here. Okay, all the other terms are of gr to the 4 at high, right, which you ignore at this order. So this way you can calculate the anomalous answer to any given order in part rotation
theory. Does
the sign have some significance? Sign has, okay, it has some significance, but not as much significance as the beta function. Okay, we'll see what it implies, because right now, this, again, this gives you some mu dependence of this wave function of Amazon class, right? We have not said so far, why mu dependence is important, right? Mu is just some arbitrary parameter which you can adjust at will, right? So why should we care about dependence on mu, right? We'll see why it's useful to know about dependence on mu, and then also it will become clear what the significance of this gamma I are, right? In particular, why these are called anomalous dimensions in the first place.
So this result
which
you have written down, is the result of acting the differential over.
That's right, yes. Yes. Oh, but this inverse, again, it starts at 1, right? Plus or a gr square.
But that is 1 by epsilon.
But again, 1 by epsilon, you shouldn't care.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. You have first collect to all terms to leading order in gr square, right? So that even though it's 1 over epsilon times gr square, right? When you multiply by this,
right,
it will give you gr to the 4.
Right. Okay.
Right? That's why there are lots of 1 over epsilon terms which have ignored, right?
Okay.
Because that they are multiplied by gr to the 4. Okay. So you collect all terms to the leading order in gr, which is gr square. Okay. And that, as you can see, doesn't have an epsilon. Right? And it is a general result that when you go to one higher order, if you collect everything, right, to that order, you will find that there is no epsilon again. Right? As you take epsilon goes to 0 limit, you get a finite result.
Exactly.
So always to give any given order, once you collect all terms, right, you will find that all the 1 over epsilon parts cancel at the end. That and you will be left with no epsilon. That is finite epsilon goes to 0. Oh, I have not said why. We'll see that when we see the significance of this term, right? Then it will become clear why it's called anomaly. Right now, it's just a name. So, okay, why is this important? It's important because this appears in this differential equation, right? So, let me write down then the differential equation that the denormalized Green's function satisfies. So the differential equation that the denormalized Green's function satisfies is mu del del mu plus eta t del del gr plus eta alpha del del alpha plus eta m del del mr plus sum over I gamma I on product I on this j. So this equation, then if you define those of interpreting this equation, so first one way, which is the way you have been saying, is that this equation tells us that if you change mu and at the same time you change the other coupling constants in an appropriate way, the unnormalized correlation functions do not change. Renormalized correlation functions do change because of the wave function normalization, and that's encoded in this gamma delta. The other way to interpret this is that this tells us that if we knew the dependence on this correlation function on the various coupling constants for fixed mu, suppose you knew the dependence on gr, alpha, and mr. Okay, this you can calculate in using perturbation theory or any other thing. Then this equation tells us how it depends on mu. In a sense, mu dependence would be trivial because mu was not a parameter that was there in the original theory, right? This has been introduced because of renormalization. Okay? So the theory cannot depend arbitrarily on mu, right? It so happens that in the correlation functions do depend on mu, but somehow the dependence on mu should be determined by some general principles, right? And that's what this equation is giving us. Okay? This equation gives a general principle, okay, which tells you how to determine how the correlation function depends on mu. If you knew how it depends on other parameters, you know how it depends on mu. Okay. So this again is saying that mu is not an independent parameter. Dependence on mu can be determined by this universal differential equation. In particular, if there is no renormalization, then beta g, beta alpha, beta m and gamma g are all zero. Okay. Suppose you didn't have to renormalize. Okay, then all of these could be set to be to zero because all the z's could be taken as one. Right? In that case, this equation will just tell you mu del del mu of this equal to zero. Right? The correlation function doesn't depend on mu. So maybe I'll not do an new thing, but let me just say what I'll be doing tomorrow. Okay. First, we'll try to derive a more general form than RG equation. Here I have taken some specific parameters. But the generic situation will be that you have some arbitrary set of coupling constants. So the generic situation. Say N fields phi I, N coupling constants, G1 to GM. And you have the following renormalization condition that phi I in general will be given by the sum over J in Z, right? And G alpha will be given by sum F alpha. Okay, this is a general, this of course also depends on GR angle in general. Okay, so this is a generic form of the relationship between the unnormalized and the normalized parameters. GR stands for this collection of all functions, G1, R2, GR. So in this case, we can again define the beta functions exactly in the way that we did earlier, namely we will demand that mu dd mu of g alpha equal to 0, and that will in turn tell us how we should change gr. So that will give an expression for mu dd mu of gr, okay, which will be a function of the gr sense, okay, by writing this. So I'll write down the general equation, and then we look at the correlation function of the renormalized operator, correlation functions like this, and see what kind of differential equation that satisfies. It will just be generalization of this. Okay, you can already see that instead of having this, there will be a sum over all beta g alpha, so it will be something like beta alpha del del g alpha. Here, it will be a little complicated. Here, as you can see that because this is a matrix, in general, it will not have a simple form like this, it will also be a matrix. Because what will appear here is not just simple numbers, but a matrix. But otherwise, the general structure of the differential equation will remain the same.
So this matrix will have this form that this matrix inverse times
G. Exactly, that's right. So it will be like earlier we have defined Zj inverse times that differential operator acting on Zj, right? Now it will be a matrix inverse of this times a differential operator acting on this matrix. Right? But of course, this is something you can calculate in principle. Okay, and that's what will give the anomalous dimension matrix, right, which will write as gamma ij. Okay, but otherwise the structure of the differential equation will be very similar. Okay, and then we will see why this equation is useful in determining something physical, right, because all that I have said so far is that it determines how it depends on mu, right, but you may wonder why do we care about dependence on mu, because mu was not a parameter that was there to begin with anyway, right. So I can set mu equal to some any fixed constant that we like, and we're done with it, right? So mu equal to 1 GeV, and why you have to change it, right? We'll see that it is useful to change it, okay? And that's why the utility of the renormalization group equation comes in. Okay, so continue. Tomorrow it will be at 5:30.